like to call the regular meeting to order at this time. This meeting is being video recorded and streamed live to the web. Madam Clerk, will you please confirm posting and roll call?
Mayor, this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Nevada Open Meeting Law. All members of the council are present and you have a quorum.
Thank you. I'd like to invite Pastor Dodgel Hekanova from the Neighborhood Church to the podium to give the invocation, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance, which will be led by Neil Johnson, President of the Vietnam Veterans of Henderson Chapter.
Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you, Lord, that we have the opportunity to gather here tonight. God, I thank you that your word says where there's a multitude of counselors, there's wisdom. We speak wisdom over the people that lead our city, God. As man plans his way, will you direct our steps? We honor you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please join us with the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Derrick, are there any changes to the agenda?
I do have a few changes, Your Honor. CA-15, which is an interlocal agreement for assistance from Henderson Police Department Chief of Police to Eureka County Sheriff's Department, has been withdrawn at the request of staff. On CA-27, which is the City of Henderson 2019-2023 Strategic Plan, a memo and revised strategic plan were distributed to Council and added to the backup earlier today. The memo outlines minor changes in multiple areas throughout the proposed strategic plan. And we've also had a request on NB-40, which is a zone change for Fairway Road Subdivision, to be continued until April 9th. And the accompanying resolution, which is B-43, again, accompanying bill number for NB-40, which again is Fairway Road Subdivision, to be continued to April 16th. And those are your changes, Your Honor.
Thank you. So if this item passes tonight, then those items will, 40 and 42 will not be heard tonight. They would be heard in April.
That's correct. One will be continued till April 9th on NB-40, and B-43 will be continued to April 16th. So they will not be heard tonight.
Thank you. Can I have a motion?
I'll move to accept the agenda as amended.
We have a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion carries. Thank you.
First section of your agenda is proclamations, commendations, and presentations. PR1 is a presentation for Henderson Elementary, Junior High, and High School Nevada State Robotics Championship teams. I'd like to invite representatives from the 2019 Nevada State Robotics Championship teams from Date Mac Elementary School, Greenspun Junior High, Basic Academy of International Studies, and Coronado High School to the podium. At Nevada State Robotics Competitions held in February, teams from these four schools won awards, and seven teams, five from Henderson, qualified for the World Championships to be held in Louisville, Kentucky in April. This week-long championship, which is in 2018 was named the largest robot competition in the Guinness World Records, brings together teams from 30 nations in a celebration of STEM, diversity, and robotics. The teams would like to present a short video on the recent state competitions and talk briefly about their plans for the World Championships. Congratulations to these award-winning robotics teams for demonstrating the quality education in our public schools, and best wishes to them for the World Championships. Welcome.
Come forward, please. And we're so proud of you, and what a wonderful accomplishment. And I know moving forward, you're going to be moving into the Nationals, and we are really proud of all that you have accomplished. I know that you're also in the process of fundraising at this time as well, so we'd like to draw attention to that. Please identify yourself for the record, too.
I'm Casey Giuliano from Nate Mack Elementary School. Good evening, Mayor March, council members. I'm here and speaking on behalf of all of the coaches. We're so honored to present our state champions. And we brought a little video to get us started in presenting our accomplishments tonight.
Please state your name for the record.
I Noor Allen from Nate Mack Elementary Robotics Team. Good evening, Council Members and Mayor March. Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you today. The members of our Henderson schools have once again made their community proud at the Nevada Robotics State Championships in February. Robotics is growing by leaps and bounds in Nevada, and for the first time, elementary was its own division with 21 teams competing from Nevada. We are proud to tell you that we swept the competition, earning 5 of the 7 awards presented. Our B team won VexIQ's highest achievement, the overall award of excellence for the state of Nevada. While at Worlds, the excellence winners present their STEM research project. The theme this year was Math in the World, and their project focuses on the math involved in building the new Raider Stadium. In a nail-biting tiebreaker, Nate Mack's other two teams collaborated in the finals match to each win the other two spots that send teams to Worlds, winning the overall teamwork awards. Additionally, Team A won the Judges Award and Team C won the Design Award. This means that all three of our teams have earned the 3 spots at the VexIQ World Championship in Louisville, Kentucky, the largest global robotics competition in April. They will be part of the 1,600 elite teams from 30 nations competing elementary through college level. We are currently working towards our goal of $28,000 to ensure all 17 of our 4th and 5th grade students are able to attend this once-in-a-lifetime experience.
My name is Jason Rossabong from the Greenspun Robotics Team. Good evening, Council Members and Mayor March. Thank you for allowing us this opportunity to talk to you. This year was a special one for our team, as we were able to win awards at each competition we attended and qualify our team for VEX Worlds for a 4th straight year. During the state championship, our team battled 64 other middle school teams, including private schools and homeschool teams. Through our hard work and perseverance, we were selected as the design and teamwork champions. The design award is given for the team with an excellent engineering journal and overall quality design. The teamwork award is given for the team pair that scores the highest in the teamwork match finals. Our team worked hard to achieve this honor and are proud to share it with you today. We continue to work at improving our robot and programs to compete at this advanced level of competition, as well as fundraise to ensure all members of our team who earned a spot at Worlds can go. Our fundraising goal this year is $10,000. With the continued support of our administration, the Henderson Chamber of Commerce, and Allegiant Airlines, we are on our way, but we still both have a long way to go. We are proud to represent the state of Nevada, and especially the city of Henderson at Worlds. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor March and council members. My name is Cody Perkins, and I'm the captain of the Wolves Robotics team at Basic Academy. I would like to start off by thanking you guys for giving us the opportunity to be here. Robotics has made a large impact on my life, as well as many other students in the school. It has created a community in which students can come build robots, hang out with friends, and have a fun and a safe environment. It allows us to practice real-world skills such as engineering, the design process, computer programming, time management, collaboration, and teamwork. For some, it has helped them find a group in school that they can be a part of and make new friends. For me, it has made high school more enjoyable, and I look forward to each school day. This year, our teams have been busy competing in a number of tournaments around Nevada and the country. Because of our success, we have been invited to play in 2 VEX Robotics signature events, tournaments that the top teams around the world are invited to compete in for a world championship spot. At the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum, we finished 9th out of 60 teams, and at the Google headquarters in California, we finished 2nd and 11th out of 80 teams. In addition, we won the state championship for the 3rd consecutive year, qualifying 2 of our teams to Worlds. We also will be competing at the U.S. National Championship for the 4th year in a row. Since many of us are seniors this year, and placing in the top 10 at both Worlds and Nationals last year, our new goal is to place in the top 5 in Nationals and Worlds this year. We know these goals require hard work and practice, as well as additional fundraising to achieve. Fortunately, the community of Henderson always steps up to help out their own, just like the generous financial support for our team from the Stater Family Foundation, Olin Chloralkali of Henderson, Broadbent, and Associates Engineering. We hope the community will once again see the value in supporting a high-quality, world-class educational program like Wolves Robotics, so we can do our best to make Henderson proud. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, council members and Mayor March. My name is Sean Masse, and I am the president of the Coronado High School Robotics Club, and we are not your ordinary high school team. For all aspiring engineers who are involved with this team, it has become their second home. Immediately after school, all of our members nearly run to the robotics room to work on the robots, and for many of our members, this is their only opportunity to do any true engineering. We get to build, code, design, test, and compete with our own creations while preparing for our future careers. All the hard work that our members have put into this team shows through our accomplishments. Just recently, we've had two of our nine teams qualify for the VEX Nationals competition and one team qualify for the VEX Worlds competition. These competitions allow us not only the opportunity to interact and learn from other teams around the country and world, but to demonstrate our engineering, teamwork, and communication skills, while all building lifelong friendships with our teammates as well as our robotics teams, like Basic High School. In order to participate in these competitions, we are fundraising for $19,000 to make this dream a reality. We are very excited to represent Henderson and Nevada on the national and world stage. So thank you very much for your generous support.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak? I have to share with you that we are so incredibly proud of what you've accomplished and look forward to what's coming. And we certainly hope that you're going to be successful at national. And as I commented earlier, you're in a stage of fundraising to make sure that these young folks can make it back to the nationals. And so this is just to let the community know that we have some bright and these are the future, the kids who are studying STEAM and science, technology, engineering, and math, and these are the future of our community and the things that they're learning and the things that they'll be able to teach in the future because of what they're learning now is amazing. And we're just so very proud of you. And we're going to come on down and do a photo op with all of you. We'd like to join you down there, so we'll be right down.
Your next item is PR2, Commendation for Principal Wendy Shuri, Milken Education Award recipient. I'd like to invite Pinecrest Academy Horizon Campus Principal Wendy Shuri to the podium to receive a commendation from the Mayor and Council in recognition of her contribution to the quality of education in Henderson. Principal Shuri recently received the Milken Educator Award, which is nicknamed the Oscars of Teaching and presented to educational professionals for the highest achievement and excellence in education. Principal Shuri was recognized for her leadership of Pinecrest Academy Horizon, which advanced from a 3-star to a 5-star rating, becoming the highest performing charter school in the state of Nevada. Principal Shuri is Nevada's only Milken Award recipient this year and the first since 2009. Congratulations to Principal Wendy Shirley for her educational leadership and for receiving the Milken Educator Award. Welcome.
Can I just say, wow, that's so impressive to receive the Milken Award. And I think the last person to receive it in Nevada might have been you, Carrie Buck. We're so proud of you. And now to have it again in Henderson, we're so thrilled that the Horizon Campus of Pinecrest has been acknowledged as well as having gone from a 3-star to a 5-star school. And you've worked very hard, and we appreciate what you've done to elevate education in our community. And to have the Milken Foundation acknowledge you and your accomplishments is huge. Thank you.
So if you'd like to say a few words.
It's overwhelming still. I'm still at a loss for words even, you know, a few months later. So thank you. Thank you, Mayor March, for allowing us to be here and for recognizing me and all of your support of our schools and for leading our wonderful community. We love Henderson.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And did you want to say a few words? And Carrie, you would.
I did want to say a few things because I'm so grateful to her. She's just turned that school around. She went into teaching because she wanted to change the world. And now as a principal, it's one student at a time. She is changing the world. She's an expert servant leader and really represents that. She changed her school around because of a data-rich approach. She grew the student data. She's an expert in grant writing. She grasps students' emotional needs and really supports the whole child. And she just cares so much. She'll also be recognized this weekend in New Orleans. Her and her husband are flying to New Orleans, and the Milken Foundation will be recognizing her there. So grateful to the mayor and the council members. Thank you for recognizing her.
Your next item is a PR3, Proclamation Emergency Preparedness and Safety Week. I'd like to invite Division Chief Ryan Turner and members of the Emergency Management and Safety Division to the podium to accept a proclamation from the Mayor and Council for Emergency Preparedness and Safety Week. Planning and preparing for an emergency can help individuals, families, and businesses stay safe when disaster strikes. The Division of Emergency Management and Safety will lead this year's initiative to promote personal office preparedness, or POP kits, to encourage workplace preparedness in addition to home preparedness in the face of disaster. To raise awareness for community preparedness and safety, the Mayor and City Council wish to proclaim the week of March 25th to 31st as Emergency Preparedness and Safety Week.
Well, can I tell you how proud we are of your department and the whole department, Chief, as well, you know, and the great things that you're doing to educate the community and to keep us safe. And I know that you're working currently on the Personal Office Preparedness Program, and maybe you could share a little bit about what you're working on. But also, it's important for us as a council to recognize this week as Emergency Preparedness and Safety Week in Henderson.
Well, Mayor and Council, we just want to thank you for your continued support. You've always been behind us and all the efforts and initiatives that we've been trying to push throughout our community. We'd like to thank our city manager, Richard Derrick, for his continued support. And really, Emergency Preparedness and Safety Week is just a week for us to just recognize that we all need to be better prepared and safe. And something that we're really trying to focus on this year is office preparedness. We spend a lot of our time away from our house and actually at work. And if an emergency were to happen at any one of our places where we work, we just want to make sure that we have a preparedness kit. We've thought about the evacuation plans just to try to create a more resilient community. So that's really what we're focusing on this next week.
Thank you very much. Make sure. Mr. Derrick.
Next section of your agenda is the City Manager's Report. The Water Street District welcomed the 53rd annual Southern Nevada Sons and Daughters of Aaron St. Patrick's Day Parade and Festival this past weekend, which was enjoyed by over 65,000 attendees. The parade included over 97 entries, and the car show showcased 173 vehicles on display. The television show Carnival Eats, which airs on the Cooking Channel, filmed three of our food vendors for an upcoming episode, which will include segments about the festival and Henderson as a foodie travel destination. Congratulations to Senior Assistant City Attorney Mark Scifalakwa for recently being appointed to the Nevada District Attorneys Association to the Nevada Prosecution Best Practices Committee. Mark was one of four prosecutors in Clark County to be appointed to the committee, whose goal is to work proactively to improve the criminal justice system by enhancing public safety with due consideration for the rights of the accused. And I believe he's in the audience today. Well, congratulations, Mark. Job well done. I'd also like to congratulate Alyssa Rodriguez for being elected to the position of International Vice President-elect for the Institute of Transportation Engineers. Alyssa will serve a four-year term and become the international president in 2 years. This position is responsible for the overall strategic planning and budgeting for the agency. And I believe she's in the audience as well, in the back. Congratulations, Alyssa. And that concludes the City Manager's Report.
Thank you, Mr. Derrick. And now it's time for the consent agenda.
That's correct. Consent agenda includes items CA4 through CA36. And there's a reminder that CA15 was withdrawn. So unless an item is pulled for discussion, council will take action on all consent agenda items with one motion, accepting the recommendations as stated on the agenda item.
Can I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Move to approve the consent agenda as amended.
We have a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion carries.
Next section of your agenda is public hearings. Page 37 is a public hearing. Appeal AP-2-19. CUP-201-800-2109, CUP-201-900-2287, DRA-201-800-2110, City of Henderson Fire Station Number 85, Hidden Falls. Your recommendation is to affirm the Planning Commission's decision to approve CUP-201-800-2109, CUP-201-900-2287, and DRA-201-800-2110.
And the City of Henderson's the applicant on this. Do we have?
Yes, I'll do it from the dice, okay. If that's okay. There is a drawing there on the table so that we can take a look. Just for mayor members of council, this item is the appeal of Planning Commission's approval of two conditional use permits and a design review for a fire station within Hidden Falls Park. The approval included a use permit for two above-ground fuel storage tanks totaling 3,500 gallons. And again, since the city is the applicant on this item, I want to address some of the concerns that were expressed at the Planning Commission meeting And then after I've done that, there are various departments present who can answer any of your questions you might have. So again, the proposed fire station will be located within the building envelope currently occupied by the existing dog park. So as you can see there on your screen, that is the area to the right on the screen. You can see one of the existing dog parks kind of poking out on the back side of that. So the proposed fire station will occupy that existing envelope. The dog parks will then be relocated there to that white area on the left. There will be temporary dog park facilities placed prior to decommissioning the existing dog park if that becomes necessary. The area is currently served by Fire Station 81 at College and Horizon, but given the growth over the past decade, the service area has become too large and too populated to maintain our service times for our residents. And so using some extensive research and GPS, we identified the intersection of Horizon and Horizon Ridge as the best location for the new fire station. We originally considered the Armory as a location, but we were told it was unavailable when we approached them. And then lastly, regarding the two above ground tanks, one is 3,000 gallons for diesel fuel, and the other is 500 gallons for diesel exhaust fluid, which is non-flammable, non-toxic, and non-hazardous. So the 3,000-gallon diesel fuel tank is a UL-2085 listed tank. And what that means is it's got seamless 6-inch reinforced concrete providing 2-hour fire protection. It has to be able to withstand fire and has been tested with a 2-hour liquid pool furnace test. And then I'm speaking way out of school here, so if you have questions about this specifically, our fire guys are here, and they're the experts. It is impact resistant, and so what that means is that the tank is required to maintain containment of fuel even after impact of 12,000 pounds force at 10 miles per hour. It's also required to resist 150 grain 30 caliber bullet shot from 100 feet at 2,700 feet per second. It has a monolithic concrete enclosure and insulation layers providing thermal protection. It has a secondary containment, which is a 30 mil high density polyurethane membrane that encloses the primary tank. And then the steel tank is then encased in concrete to ensure corrosion protection. So the UL-2085 tank is one of the safest tanks that we have out there, which is why we require it for this type of above ground storage. So with that, both Planning Commission and staff supported this application, and the recommendation is to affirm Planning Commission's approval.
Thank you. Well, this is a public hearing item. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Please come forward. And please state your name and your zip code for the record.
John Matta, 89002. I live right behind the park. And the only thing I question is, you're going to move the dog parks to that side of the mountain. And that's going to kind of get crazy, because when we did the park, we talked about that, and the dogs will be there all day, and they're going to wake up dogs right along the side there, where the houses are. Is there any other place you can put the dog parks away from that part of the park?
Mr. Derrick, that's a good question. Is there something that we can do to have him meet with staff and maybe talk about the location of the dog park?
Yeah, we can certainly look. That site is it's a large site. We have about 60-acre park site there.
Right.
The problem is there's quite a bit of topography, and the site where the dog park is now, or where the fire station is proposed, was blasted. So it would be quite a bit of work, but we can look. I mean, there's physical space, whether it's appropriate for a dog park, but happy to take a look.
People in that area would appreciate that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing.
Mayor, if I might, this item is an appeal. So I don't know if the appellant is actually here to appeal their case.
Is the appellant here? I don't see the appellant, so we'll go ahead and close the public hearing portion. Are there any questions or comments from the council? We have a motion on the floor to affirm the Planning Commission's decision. Please vote. And that motion carries. And let's just make sure that we meet with this gentleman to talk about his concerns. Thank you. Next item.
Your next item is PH 38, a public hearing, appeal AP-3-19, waiver of standards, WOS-201-800-2145, design review, DRA-201-800-1899, Ruby 9, RV Garage, Studio, and Man Cave. Your recommendation is affirm the Planning Commission's decision to deny WOS-201-800-2145 and DRA-201-800-1899.
Mayor and members of City Council, this item is an appeal of the Planning Commission's decision to deny a waiver of standards application and a design review for an accessory structure at 2288 Trafalgar Court within the Fountains community. Since the denial at Planning Commission, the applicant has worked with staff to modify their proposal to reduce the square footage waiver from an 11.7% deviation to an 8.4% deviation to eliminate the need for the setback waiver and to reduce the height waiver. There is a memo that's been added to the backup that includes details to those modifications. Again, the options are to affirm, reverse, or modify Planning Commission's denial. However, staff did recommend approval.
Mr. Garcia.
Mayor, members of the council, George Garcia, 1055 Whitney Ranch Drive, Suite 210. Pleasure to be before you tonight. And with me, I'll let the applicant, my client, introduce himself.
Gary Rayner, 2324 Casota Court, zip code 89074. And appreciate
closer to the microphone.
Yeah. Yes. Gary Rayner, 89074 from the Fountains. And I very much appreciate your time, Mayor and Councilwoman and Councilman. For hearing this.
So let me go ahead and while we have on the overhead, if you can go to that, you can see a depiction of this property. And what we have here is, this is actually two lots in the Fountains. Here's the principal home here facing Trafalgar. And to the back here is what was originally the second lot. And at the time they were consolidated into one lot. The accessory structure is going to go on the back portion of the lot. And the site plan for that, basically depicting in the same orientation is the house, the main house here, and then at the back, the accessory structure. Here we can zoom up a little bit. There we go, perfect, thanks. So the accessory structure now, as staff has indicated, we revised the plan to move it back to conform to the code requirements. So that removes that waiver, which we've asked and staff's recommended, and we've requested that waiver as well. So of the two remaining, which is the height and the square footage of the site, we also recalculated those with the architect basically providing corrected information at our direction. The result was that the square footage is now within the area, which would have been an administrative approval possible. So we think that basically reduces it dramatically to the point where hopefully you'll find it acceptable. Go to the picture here that we've depicted. You can see the house accessory structure in the house next door. That's the house next door. This is the accessory structure at the back of the lot. And you can see that in many respects it looks like a house. But to put that in perspective, there's two parts of the code that reflect the height issue. So under the code, there's one provision that says for an accessory structure, you're not supposed to go above 24 feet to the peak of the roof. Now, getting a two-story structure as depicted in the code and getting it with a peaked roof is basically impossible. But the cutoff for that 24 feet would actually be reflected about this point here. To do that would create a flat roof. Well, the second part of the code that has to be considered is that it requires design compatibility with the principal structure. So in order for the accessory structure to do that, as you can see, we've had, here's the white is the accessory structure, and in the back we have the principal structure. You can see both of these have this sort of peaked roof here, so we're to pick up and emulate the design of the principal structure, which reflects the aesthetic compatibility required by the code. We've achieved that design. So that's why one of the reasons the height requirement's required. A second reason is you can maybe see here that there's a mechanical suite that's partially above that 24 feet as well. That's a basis for an exception under the code. So in reality, there's a very small portion of the height of the building that requires a waiver, and I think staff has acknowledged it. And both, I think, in our recommendation, in our conclusions and staff's recommendation to you is that it meets the basis for a height waiver. The square footage waiver is a little bit deceptive because while the square footage here is not the two floors, there's actually a floor below ground, which is our basement. And then that's actually the largest portion of the accessory structure, two-thirds of it, and therefore not even visible, but it's technically part of the calculations. But again, based on the revised calculations, it's less than the 10% that allows for the administrative approval of a waiver. And with that, I think I'd like to point out two other critical considerations. One is that the Fountains Property Homeowners Association has, the Design Review Committee has actually approved the plans. So I provide that for you in the record. We also have a substantial number of neighbors in support of the application, and we provide those here. You can see we have three sheets of essentially of approvals in support of the application. And the application, that all of the pictures and diagrams and things basically they've seen or talked to Mr. Rayner, and he's presented it to them, and they're in support of the changes, as was the association. And with that, Mayor, I'll turn it over to Mr. Rayner, but we certainly think that this is, we've hopefully provided you with enough basis to find that the waivers are appropriate, consistent, and compatible with the neighborhood.
Thank you, Mr. Garcia. Mr. Rayner.
Thank you. Well, first I must say that I'm proud to be a Henderson resident. We've been here for 6 years, and this development is the third house that we bought here. So we are going to be investing very substantially in the Fountains. This is our third house in the Fountains. We'll be putting about $7 million total into this property. And we hope that this will be a signal for the rest of the homeowners. Many have done a nice job of bringing their homes up into the 2020s, and some are still in the 1990s. So we're hoping we can encourage more investment in the Fountains as well, give them confidence to do so. And I'd also like to acknowledge and thank personally the many neighbours that have actually turned up in here in support of the project. And if I could ask those in the audience that are from the Fountains that are in support of this project, please stand up. Thank you so much. I really appreciate this. I know it's difficult with young children to make it down here on a night like this.
Thank you.
Thank you. I do have, this is a public hearing item, and I do have a number of cards. I do have three cards of individuals that don't wish to speak but want to share their support of, they want the Planning Commission decision reversed and support the applicant. And it's Terry Leftwich, Jim Leftwich, and Boyd Martin. So I won't call you up to speak, but I do have a number of cards of folks that do want to speak on this item. First is Terry Van Noy, and Terry, if you'd come forward, state your name and your zip code for the record.
Thank you, Mayor and Councilman. My name is Terry Van Noy. I've been a resident of the Fountain since 1995. I live at 2312 Prometheus Court, and I'm very much in favor of this. I've seen the Fountains. It's a beautiful, beautiful community. Some of the houses are getting a little tired, and we've had a number of major remodels, which take some time and some patience from all of us, but I think it's a very appropriate consideration. It helps improve the property values of everybody. And the location of this particular property, as you enter the Fountains, it'll be really kind of set the benchmark. And so I very much support the application and reversing the denial. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next is Lana Burns. Again, if you'd state your name and your zip code for the record.
Hi, my name is Lana Burns, 89074, and I too am here, councilmen and councilwomen, to support the Rayners. I drive by their home, their future home, every day, and it's just gorgeous. And also, speaking as a former community association manager, it seems that they are adhering to all the policies and all the stipulations that need to be. So I would see no reason to deny. And again, pardon me, as a Fountain resident myself, my family is very excited for it to also increase our property values. So thank you.
Thank you. Ray Chapler, and behind him will be Marie and Michael Chapler. Please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Yes, Ray Chapler, 89074. I live in the Fountains, and I live on Trafalgar, and I'd like to see how many people that are supporting this motion live on Trafalgar Court. Would they all stand up? The ones that live on Trafalgar Court? Not one of them. The reason is that in the Fountains, we have a 35-foot minimum setback on all the homes in Trafalgar Court. Mr. Raymer's house has a 51-foot setback on his home. And so what this is doing, the traditional value on the wall that they showed in that picture. Could I have the picture that you have there? Could I have the picture that you have? Well, it shows that it's very near the wall, which is 40 foot back. It isn't. It's not where. No, it's not here. Yeah, this one here. How do we do this? Right there. If you see over here, I can't see, but you'll see that it shows that this wall, which is an existing wall, is almost even to the garage that they're showing. That's not true. That wall is 40 feet back. I personally measured it. The driveway that they're proposing to put in on the residential area, it's 40 feet wide. It's as large as the entrance to a Walmart. The depth of the RV garage is 54 feet. A Greyhound bus is 45 feet. It's 9 feet longer than a Greyhound bus. The width of the structure for the bus is 20 feet. A Greyhound bus is 8.5 feet. The height of a Greyhound bus is 12.5 feet. This is over 22 feet. The garage portion of it, which you would park a car, is 30 feet in depth and 16, this is for each car, is 30 feet in depth and 16 feet wide. There's no vehicle that's made that it's necessary to have anything of this size. This is overkill. And also, the reason I say it's not a garage is this building has three full bathrooms with tubs. I don't know any other. I don't know any garage that has that. I don't know any garage that has two automatic dishwashers. I don't know any garage that has two clothes dryers. I don't know anyone that has two refrigerators in the garage.
Thank you.
I don't know anyone that has two kitchenettes in a garage. I don't know anybody any garage that has two garbage disposals in the garage. What this really is, and the plans have been revised as of yesterday. They've resubmitted the plans to make it more appealing because it was obvious from the old plans that this was not going to be used as it wasn't going to be used as a building, but it's going to be used as a where somebody would live there. The original plans, and I think they're still in there, which they've modified, they had a bathroom. The entrance of the bathroom was you go into the bathroom, and then outside on another door in the bathroom, it went into a closet. It was labeled a closet that was 13 foot by 13 foot. And then that closet went into another closet.
We have 3 minutes allowed for each of the speakers.
Anyway, That was a bedroom.
And thank you.
They've eliminated that portion of it. But it's obvious to me that you don't put two kitchenettes, you don't put three full bathrooms, you don't do all this stuff if you're just building just building an RV.
And the applicant will have a chance to respond to that.
Thank you.
Ask him to. Thank you. Marie Chapler. Thank you. Marie, would you state your name and your zip code for the record?
My name is Marie Chaplar, 89074.
Thank you.
And I am here on behalf of the neighbor adjacent to the property, Carolyn Pelly, and she's asked me to read the letter that she submitted to the council. Dear Mayor, council members, again, I am the Fountains property owner, Pelly Family Trust, and resident of the home at 2271 Trafalgar Court, Henderson, Nevada, 89074, located immediately to the west and abutting the southern half of the long-established and long-developed, since before December 1993, double lot located at 2288 Trafalgar Court. I would like to thank the Planning Commission for denying the above-cited applications at the hearing on February 14th, 2019. I would also request that the mayor, council members, and city clerk affirm the Planning Commission's decision to deny this project. In addition to my letter of February 12th, 2019, as well as the video audio record of the February 14th, 2019 hearing, applications and all other documents of record for the cited applications, I have these additional comments and concerns. The Fountains Property Owners Association, DRC response to owner, dated October 17th, 2018, states, please note all approvals are subject to the following. Must observe all setback requirements. Your improvements must comply with all city, county building ordinances. Must review the section of the CC&R's DRC guidelines pertaining to property improvements prior to commencement of the project. Since a property owner is seeking violations of the above, the approval should be considered invalid. In addition, no one from the DRC and or Board of Directors signed the response. Only Ms. Roberts, and she is no longer there. DRC actions are required to be a recordable document. Yet this response provides no information about their actions or even what they reviewed. When I asked Ms. Roberts for the DRC's report and what they looked at, she informed me that it's secret, as is the name of the property owner. The Fountains CC&R state, the DRC committee shall keep and maintain a record of all actions taken by it. As I recall from the hearing and application documents, the planning commissioner in the hearing ferreted out from the architect that the two side-by-side male and female full bathrooms and bathtubs located in the represented man cave were for large groups, and the architect mentioned church.
Can you wrap up your comments?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next is Michael Chapler. Please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Yes, Michael Chapler, 89074. Basically, we're here to talk about the variances or what they're asking for to get the property through. The height is one of the biggest restrictions because it's 9 feet above what would otherwise be allowed. They stated that there's mechanical things such as heaters and things in that space to make that requirement. However, in the basement, there's a 350-square-foot generator room that could adequately put any kind of mechanical things into it to get that roof level down. Also, there's a concern that my mom didn't get to read it, but the attorney for Mr. Rayner noted that he may subdivide this property at some point and make it two houses and build another house. The problem with the current setback at 20 feet is that that would not be far enough back, considering the other houses are at 35 feet. The code for R6 right now, the current code, is 25 feet setback. But the code that's in the fountains that the property owners have is 35. The DRC of the Design Review Committee reviewed plans that were from September of this year. They have not seen anything since then. So any of these changes that have gone through have not been seen. It has not been approved by them. The houses that are next to the property, the primary residence is 130 feet away from this auxiliary building. The neighbors are all much closer to that property than the actual homeowner is on that residential site. And that site that's going to be the ancillary building is 6,000 square feet. The house next to it's 5,600, and two houses across from it are 4,000, 4,200. Basically, the regulations for the city of Henderson says that on accessory buildings, that they should not create adverse impacts on surrounding lots, and they must be carefully subordinate in area, extent, purpose, and to their principal use or structure. Lastly, as I mentioned, the DRC, that's already been kind of said there, this basically is a conditional approval. If the ordinances are not followed or if the setbacks are not followed, this is pulled back. Finally, I want to put into record that this is also in Carolyn's statement. There was a social media post that went out for people to join here today. And it talks about us neighbors being ferocious in our opposition to this. It talks about that we're NIMBY neighbors, that we don't want anything changed. And NIMBY, I had to look up, it's not in my backyard. Problem is, this is not in our backyard. If it was in our backyard, it'd be fine. It's in our front yard. And the last thing that I really find, I don't even know what to say to this. She makes this, like this is a party today. It says, if I may finish. Mm-hmm. I know it's close to dinner. And she's asking people, bring your kids. It will be a great educational experience for them. I know it's close to dinner. If you message me, I can bring you and your family a tasty dinner, drinks, and dessert to the event. This is not a party. This is something that is affecting our property values, and I'm really offended that I think a number of the people here are here on promise of some sort of.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
Next is Valerie Farrow.
Huh?
Please state your name and your zip code for the record, Valerie.
It's in there.
My name is Valerie Favreau, 89074. First of all, I'm a real estate appraiser.
Oh, okay.
And I moved into the Fountains because of how lush and beautiful it is. And when I saw this house get purchased and the amount of work that they're putting into it, I got very excited because I know this is only going to help our values. I really don't understand what he means, because having this happen to the Fountains is going to enhance our value. It's going to make people get excited, as you had said. And it's upsetting when you hear this, because the one thing we all have to understand is if you were in that neighborhood, they actually have the whole entire street. So there really should be a house there. And that house is actually not that big if you want to call it an accessory unit or, you know, a building, a garage. I've seen the plans. It's going to be gorgeous. It's going to be beautiful. They're not building a shack. And as far as the setback, when you drive, I wish I had my camera and my photo, but I looked at houses and drove around, and there's garages that are set back like 20 feet, 15 to 20 feet on other streets, and it looks beautiful. Just because of where it sits, just because it's across the street, it doesn't make it ugly. It's going to be a beautiful project, and the only thing it's going to do for our neighborhood is help our neighborhood, because there are some houses that are really not, people are just kind of letting them go. But now I'm starting to see a little excitement. I'm seeing a lot of bins out front when I go running in the morning. And I really think this is going to help. And I wish they could just see that, because there's no way. After that's done, I know it's going to bring our property values up. The Fountains is a unique property in itself, just living in there. But it needs some updating. People need to start, doing more updating, because it's just a beautiful neighborhood of Henderson. And I don't think they're doing anything to hurt us, that's for sure. There wouldn't be houses in there buying houses three times if they were trying to hurt their neighborhood. So
thank you.
That's all I have to say.
Next card is Sam Harding. Please come forward, state your name and your zip code for the record.
Good evening, My name is Sam Harding. Good evening, Mayor and Council people. I live at 2322 Caserta Court and have lived there in the Fountains for approximately 20 years. Gary, at the present time, is my next door neighbor, and he has bought a new house that he's here requesting a reversal of the denial and approval of the waiver. I've known Gary since he's been there. He's an excellent neighbor. He's kept the place. He's improved the house next door to me, increasing the value in our neighborhood. He is doing a tremendous job at the new residence. I've seen the plans. And what he is putting in there is going to help every homeowner there with the value of their property. So I can't speak strongly enough to request that you reverse this denial and approve the waiver. It's going to really help the Fountains. Anybody who drove by there and looked at what's going on there would say, wow, I wish that was going on in my neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. Glenn Favreau, and please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Hi, I'm Glenn Favreau. I'm 2285 Buckingham Court, also in the Fountains. And I personally want to thank Mr. Rayner over here for coming into our community and enhancing this property. This property had severe deferred maintenance. I see absolutely nothing wrong with the construction. It's very, very high end. And my wife was also an appraiser, and I have appraised basically in every subdivision, not only in Henderson, but also in all of Clark County. They've been appraised homes in those subdivisions. And on a high-end quality home, like Mr. Rayner is constructing, it's not uncommon to have this type of a unit. I know it's going to enhance values. I'm happy to see it there, and I think the majority of the people in that community would support the decision for him to be able to build that unit. I walk by there almost every day, and I can tell you, it's very high-end quality, excellent construction, and it can do nothing but other than to beautify that whole community. And it's something that we really, really need, because there are a lot of homes in there that need some work. And it's nice to see Mr. Rayner bringing his home into the 2020. So I hope that you let him go forward with this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Rosa Solis Rainey. Please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Thank you, Mayor and Council members. My name is Rosa Solis Rainey, and my zip code is also 89074. And I don't want to belabor the point. I'm not here for a free dinner. I'm simply here to support my neighbor. He lives down the street. I don't know that we've actually met, because I'm always coming and going with kids. But it's all the neighbors in our cul-de-sac are wonderful neighbors. There's only 8, I believe, cul-de-sacs in our neighborhood. I also drive by the new structure every day, and it looks like they're doing a wonderful job. So I hope you support and allow him to do his construction.
Thank you. Miss Sheila Harding, please state your name and your zip code.
Hello, Mayor and Council.
I am Sheila Harding. Into the microphone,
I am Sheila Harding. Thank you. And I live at 2322 Caserta Court, 89074. As my husband stated, we have been in the Fountains almost 20 years. Mr. Rayner and his family moved in, and we have been very happy with them as a neighbor. They have been very considerate of the people around them. And I feel that whatever he is designing is going to accommodate the needs and the expectations of his neighbors. I believe that he should be granted what he would like to build, because it is a beautiful facility and it will accommodate his needs as well as everyone else's. Thank you.
Thank you. Joy Snyder. Joy. Snyder here? Okay, we'll go ahead and move that on. Aaron Timrawi? Okay. Frank Blanco? Okay. Christine Zach. Please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Christine Zach, 89074. Mayor, council members, I am the president of the Fountains Property Owners Association. I am not here in that capacity this evening. I'm here as a 5+ year member of the Fountains community. I moved to this beautiful neighborhood because I'm a Northeast girl. And in the Fountains, I found my 2-story brick home with a basement with 13 pine trees. And it reminds me of growing up in Pennsylvania. What makes the Fountains so unique is that every single home and property is different. They are custom homes that are truly of the highest quality. Since I moved to the Fountains approximately 5 years ago, I have made it my mission to enhance our community through starting a social committee, through starting a safety and security committee on which Gary Rayner was one of the original members and very active in helping us work with the Henderson Police Department in improving safety, preventing home burglaries, preventing car break-ins. And in fact, we're now at a point where Henderson Police Department is welcome into our community and uses our clubhouse to write reports. And we made modifications to that clubhouse for them to invite them into the community. What Mr. Rayner and his family are doing is truly stunning, and it will indeed enhance all of our properties and increase our property values. I ask you to please think carefully about this request to overturn the denial and to permit Mr. Rayner and his family to have the waiver. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Blanco?
Sorry, I was in the back.
No, state your name and your zip code for the record.
Frank Blanco. I'm in support of the project, and I spend a lot of time at the Rayner's home, and I'm family and also relative, but I just love the neighborhood, and I just enjoy the project, seeing things being done, and just and support of it.
Thank you.
Just very simply in support of it, and I would appreciate that. We'd be in favor for them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next card is K-Jack at Majian. Please state your name and your zip code for the record.
K-Jack at Majian. This is my wife, Annette at Majian. We live at 2268 Trafalgar Court. If I can put this like that. This is where we live, and that's the property. If you realize today, everybody's talking about the front house, nothing about the back, the RV garage, or the man cave. The community, the way it's built, when you enter the community, you're on a watermark street going to your home. If you don't live on Trafalgar, you will never drive on Trafalgar Street. So most of my neighbors, they don't live on this street. They all live on other streets. So if you go in on Trafalgar, it will take you nowhere but back out to the watermark. This project is facing straight to our front yard. It will be huge. RV parking there. We will see it every day. And I hope my fellow neighbors that they live on Trafalgar, they already talk exactly what I was gonna talk about, the setback, the height, and all those kind of things. We strongly object about this project. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. That's all the cards I have. Is there anyone else wishing to speak on this item that I haven't called on? Please come forward, sir. George, there's still some folks that wish to speak. Please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Eugene Speck, 89074. I do live at the Fountains. I've lived there since 1993. And I'm here to tell you, you've got a monstrosity on your hands. I look at it only as from an aesthetic point of view. I really don't care that it does or does not add to the value of the homes. I have no concerns about that. I think it will eventually increase the values, but the home itself is incongruous with the rest of the Fountains in its demeanor, in its size of all the other homes. And I would suggest to you that if you have any doubts about this, you should go out there and take a look at this structure for yourself. I suspect the best way to build this home is mostly underground. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing portion. George, if you'd come forward and respond to some of the things that were.
Thank you, Mayor. Let's start with the kind of reverse order. First off, the most of the accessory structure is underground, so that's number one. Number two, this is a custom lot, I think, as one of the speakers indicated. As a custom lot subdivision, you expect every home to have a unique character and design, but this is, I think, clearly in keeping with a double lot in terms of its scale and size and the way it's placed on the property. According to the code, we meet the code requirements for the setback, so that waiver is gone. According to the HOA, we meet the design review committee's requirements and expectations, so we don't think there's an issue there, although it's been raised, but then that's between the property owners and the HOA. We think with respect to the height, we provided ample information along with staff that the height waiver is reasonable, justified, most importantly, because it creates, in my opinion, design compatibility, so the home does look consistent with the principal house, which is what it's intended to do. As to some of the issues with what are the fixtures in the house, how many fixtures, what are they for, and everything else, we've provided staff drawings that show that this is not an accessory dwelling, that this is not anything of that nature. That would be a separate conditional use permit application. This is strictly for the waivers for an accessory use. There are no building code issues there are on that with that regard. The planning department has found no issues with the internal concepts that have been presented to you. So from that standpoint, we meet those issues as well. In terms of the way it's going to function, clearly the downstairs is partly it's an entertainment area for the family and their friends. There's a large pool between the principal and the accessory structure, and in that, so this also functions like a cabana where there's both restrooms and changing rooms in the accessory structure. The RV has a permanent home, and if you, Gary, if you have some of the photographs, you'll find that not unlike other places in the neighborhood. You can see here where there's RV parking and garages facing the street here. This is actually a larger facility in terms of the garage appearance to it, because it's all garages, and that's on Casarita Court. It's on the exhibit, the address there. So this is pretty typical. We also have here another example here. You can see, again, with garages in terms of the way they face the street, and the setback here is actually, consistent with what we're proposing. And again, this is not the front of the house, so the setback to the front of the house, which was mentioned to be very large, it is still very large at the front of the house. This is to the accessory garage structure, so having the reduced setback at 20 feet is consistent and appropriate with what's in the neighborhood and required by code. And I think one of the real issues here is, at the end of the day, the HOA found it's a good fit, and the residents here, the many of which you have, as well as the petition, all think it's a good fit. In fact, six of the people on the petition are in Trafalgar Court, so they are actually in support. So it's many people in the Fountains, and then those specifically, the closest proximity, all on Trafalgar, find this to be a good fit and a good increase in the value to the properties and appearance of the community. So with that, I think we'd be happy to answer any questions, Mayor and Council.
I think it's probably appropriate just for the audience to understand a couple things about the city. Number one is that the city does not get involved with any HOA issues. We're not here to enforce them. We're not here to talk about whether they are accurate, legal, or anything to do with HOA issues. So whether or not this particular structure complies with the HOA rules is not the city's issue. And we have never been involved in the HOA issues. So from the city's point of view, we look at this structure and say, you know, it is asking for a couple of waivers. One of the primary waivers is the height issue. I have been out and looked at this, and quite frankly, I won't say a majority, but a very large number of the homes in the Fountains already exceed the height issue. And so this accessory structure does in fact blend in with most of the homes out there because they already exceed the height issue. So I don't see that as a big issue. As far as compliance with the setback, we look at the city rules and not the HOA rules, and it does comply with that. So, you know, the alternative is this is a separate lot, and he could build a very large house there, quite frankly. So this is, in my opinion, I don't think this is a problem, and I think I can support this, so.
Councilwoman? Yes, Mayor, and this is just so we can have some clarification for a couple of the questions. One of the residents had mentioned you have the mechanical, you know, and he had asked why can't you put that in the basement? So would you be able to respond to that?
I think, yes, Mayor, I think that's pretty typical. I mean, in most homes they have mechanical units up in the upper level. I think the one gentleman was speaking about having a generator in the basement. That generator is not the hot water heater. It's not the reverse osmosis. It's not the HVAC units. So that's a different function on the lower level. So this is all provided consistent, I think, with typical housing construction throughout the valley to have those types of mechanical. In fact, in this case, they're actually be larger because of the size of the home, or the accessory structure.
Okay. And then there was the question of the wall. Now, what we have is a picture, so it's not 3D, so we can't figure out the measurement of that wall on the side. The one gentleman had mentioned that it's flush. Is it flush or is it set back, or what is that?
Well, Gary can answer, but if you go to the overhead, you can see on the site plan, it actually depicts where that wall is relative to the accessory structure. So you can, here's the accessory structure. Here's the walls as it wraps around and curves at the corner and then ties into the house here. It's actually not flush with the front. It's set back from the front. And over here on the side abutting the home, that wall is also back again from the front elevation of the home. So it is not flush. There's depth to it, and it's receding from the front towards the back.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, because I mean that's why with myself, if I look at a picture and it's just a flat picture, I can't tell what the depth is at all. So thank you for clarifying that.
Thank you. Good question.
And the last issue is the space of the garage. You know, that you could put a Greyhound bus, but you know, honestly, garages have to be larger than the vehicles. So I don't know how large your RV is. Or will be. I don't know if you're purchasing that, but I do know that in order to put an RV in an RV garage, you're going to have extra space on the sides, extra length, extra height.
Right.
So I think it's just something that you just have to. I mean, all of us, we can't just put a car in garage and say our car is 5 feet wide, and that's as wide as the garage is going to be. You have to have that extra space. And if you're building something custom, you know, for me, I want to build some extra space too. Maybe put some workbench in there, or whatever else that you want to do. If you want to put a bathroom in the garage area because you don't want to have to run into the house if you're, you know, out working in the RV, or maybe you're packing stuff in there, getting ready for a trip, you don't want to run into the house. I understand that you would want to have something additional in there. So I don't have a problem with this accessory structure. I think that from the looks of it, it's going to blend in with what the main home looks like. And I agree that all the houses that I've seen over in the Fountains are all different from each other. And some of them are larger. I know of one house that has 7 bathrooms in it. And I don't know why anybody would need 7 bathrooms when there was only 3 people living in the house. But it's it's your own personal home. And if this is what somebody wants, then and they're allowed to have it, then that person should be allowed to have whatever they want in their house.
allow the necessary waivers.
We have a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion carries. Thank you.
Mayor and Council, thank you. Good night.
Next on your agenda is new business. NB 39's appointment for Councilman John F. Mars, Senior Citizens Advisory Committee. The recommendation is to appoint.
Yes, I'd like to appoint Steve Boyce to the Senior Citizens Advisory Commission with his term to expire June 30th, 2021.
We have a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion carries.
As a reminder, NB 40 has been continued to April 9th. So that takes us to NB 41, which is a resolution for Henderson Fire Station 83 expansion. Your recommendation is adopt as resolution number 4337.
Mayor, I'll move to adopt.
We have a motion on the floor, please. Okay, we need to do a voice vote because the system isn't working. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And all opposed? Okay, this motion passes.
Your next item is NB 42. It's a resolution in opposition to the transfer of radioactive plutonium to the state of Nevada. Mayor and Council, in January, the Department of Energy revealed to the state of Nevada that it had transferred 0.5 metric ton of weapons-grade plutonium from South Carolina to the Nevada National Security Site. This was revealed after the state of Nevada filed a complaint in federal district court in November of 2018. They requested a preliminary injunction to halt the transfer of plutonium into the state, but was denied, in part because the shipment has already occurred prior to the court filing. The state is currently appealing that decision. The Nevada Governor's Office has requested the City of Henderson to support the appeal of this decision and their efforts to require the Department of Energy to work with the state and local leaders in good faith, require the DOE to remove this radioactive material and not to ship future material to Nevada.
Thank you. I do have a card for this item, and it's someone who wishes to speak. It's a Tom Stampahar. Tom, would you come forward and state your name and your zip code for the record?
Tom Stampahar, zip code 89015. I saw this application, and it just reminds me of radiation paranoia. And I get the plutonium and everything, but any other radioactive waste or material, I mean, there's hospitals in the state of Nevada. They get radioactive shipments every day. I just, if you're going to pass something, I think the wording needs to be careful. That's my only concern. And the other part, which I'm sure you're aware of, is that the Department of Transportation rules and regulations on any open road, you're going to get radioactive shipments. And you have Nellis Air Force Base. They also ship radioactive plutonium and things. I just think it's a feel-good agenda item that you don't really have jurisdiction or impact. Anyhow.
Any other comments? Councilwoman?
I just wanted to mention, last week I was in, and I'm going to do a report in a few minutes in the Mayor and Council comments, but last week I was in Washington, D.C., with the National League of Cities Conference. And we addressed the plutonium shipments with each member of our Nevada congressional delegation. Every member, both Democrat and Republican, Northern Nevada and Southern Nevada, expressed outrage at the DOE's actions and promised to work with Governor Sisolak. Senator Cortez Masto has also pledged to put a hold on all DOE nominations until this matter is resolved. And we did have a conversation with Governor Sisolak about this too, and which generated our conversation about having this item on the agenda. But you know, I think it's a matter, first of all, you know, plutonium is not a safe product. And to have that ship without notification to the state, to the local governments, is an outrage. And so I'm going to be in support of this resolution. This is our way of saying how the city of Henderson feels about this.
I just do, for your clarification, this is in reference to the Department of Energy shipments only and does not relate to medical shipments or any other uses. So I think it's right, but I think that the resolution that the governor's referring to refers to only DOE shipments. So we'll clarify that for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Yeah.
Councilman.
Yeah, Mr. Voskoff, if I might put you on the spot here for just a second, brought up it's not our jurisdiction. We shouldn't even be worried about this. If you could explain a little bit about what this resolution is about, maybe that will help ease folks' minds. Because in my mind, I'd like to say this is a state's rights issue and then go all ballistic on everybody on it. But if you could explain that for us, I'd appreciate it.
Sure. For the record, Nick Voskoff, city attorney. So certainly we don't have jurisdiction in terms of telling the federal government what to do. However, we are in the business of developing community here. And so we have an interest in how they do this. One of the things that the resolution does concentrate, I think, in its wording on is the lack of communication and cooperation that we've had from the federal government. And that, I think, obviously is something that is a concern that we should voice, if that's one you care to.
Thank you. I do have some remarks that I want to read into the record. The federal government's decision to transport highly radioactive weapons-grade plutonium to the State of Nevada National Security Site in Southern Nevada without coordinating with the state poses a serious and unacceptable risk to the environment, the economy, and the health and welfare of the residents of the City of Henderson and the State of Nevada. During the City of Henderson's outreach to the legislature in February, our leadership team met with Governor Sisolak, who directly requested that the city support of the state's efforts regarding the plutonium shipments to Nevada, and that the U.S. Department of Energy secretly authorized these shipments. The City of Henderson shares Governor Sisolak's outrage at the Department of Energy's failure to advise the State of Nevada of its decision to transport this dangerous shipment. We concur with the state in its belief that the Department of Energy has failed to adequately study the potential dangers of moving the material to an area that's not only subject to flash floods and earthquakes, but may already be contaminated with radioactive material. The fact that the Department of Energy led our state to believe that it was acting in good faith negotiations regarding the plutonium, only to later realize that we had been duped, this is unacceptable. The actions of the Department of Energy clearly demonstrate a lack of respect for the sovereignty of our state and put the welfare of our 3 million residents and more than 50 million tourists in jeopardy. Through this resolution, the City of Henderson is formally calling on the U.S. Department of Energy Secretary Rick Perry to immediately halt any future shipments of plutonium or other radioactive waste material to the State of Nevada and to inform appropriate state officials of a timeline for the removal of the plutonium shipped from the state of South Carolina. In addition, we also called for the Department of Energy to adequately and timely inform appropriate state officials of any future plans of the Energy Department to transfer plutonium or other radioactive waste materials to the state. Finally, the resolution being voted on today formally calls on the Department of Energy to cooperate and coordinate with the Henderson Emergency Management Department within the context and appropriate operational security and to ensure that the state and local governments are ready, aware, equipped, and trained when the federal government transports harmful radioactive material through their jurisdiction. The city looks forward to working in coordination with the governor, our state legislature, and our state's federal representatives in a bipartisan manner to swiftly and successfully resolve this situation. And I think a big concern for us is that this was done without our knowledge, and we should be well aware to protect the interest of our citizens in this community. Thank you. No, thank you. Any other questions or comments?
I'll move to adopt the resolution.
We have a motion on the floor. Please vote. Okay, again, this will be a voice vote. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed, say nay. This item passes.
As a reminder, B43 has been continued to your April 16th meeting.
Thank you. And now this is the time set aside for mayor and council member comments. Councilwoman, you had some comments?
Yes, and please bear with me because you know me that I like to report back whenever I go to any conference what was discussed and what the issues are. So I went to the National League of Cities conference last week, and there was a lot of different issues that have come up in a lot of different areas that we're working on. So, and some of it is national, some of it is state concerns or issues. So first I'm going to go through the National League. I just want to preface, National League of Cities advocates for cities, towns, and villages to drive solutions for the 280 million people who call our communities home. The priorities we have, the first one I'm going to talk about is the 5G preemption. Federal Communications Commission recently adopted a regulation that eliminates most local government authority over the siting of 5G infrastructure. The regulation shortens the shot clock that local governments have to review proposed siting of 5G equipment. The regulation also contains a definition of effective prohibition that invites challenges to long-standing local rights-of-way requirements. Further, the regulation contains a fee structure that severely limits the fees that local governments can charge for access to their rights-of-way. Representative Anna Eshoo from California has introduced H.R. 530, the Accelerating Broadband Development by Empowering Local Communities Act of 2019, that would render the FCC's regulations unenforceable. So we discussed this with our congressional delegation, and they're all supportive of making sure that local governments are in control of where we want to put whatever it is that needs to be put. So if you have carriers that want to bring some broadbands and put some cell towers up for small cells, you know, the thing is, in this case, they would have to put a cell every 50 feet. And what they want to do is they want to just go ahead and put these things up and bypass us in the city of Henderson or any jurisdiction in the country to be able to just go ahead and put these things up without coming to us. And of course, we're very mindful of where things are placed and how they look as well. And in addition, they want to give a shot clock to where there's a minimum between 60 and 90 days for the city to be able to make a decision on a site. And if the city does not, then they're able to just go ahead and do, you know, put it wherever they want. And so we want to prevent that from happening, especially in local government. It takes a while for things to get on agendas and get discussions. And then also the limitation of the fees that we could charge for access for the rights of way. So that's a really big issue that we were discussing. We were also, another priority is infrastructure. Marijuana banking, public lands transfers for public purposes and economic development, municipal bonds, making sure that they continue to keep the tax exemption on municipal bonds. And then also we had discussed reinstatement of the tax exemption for advanced refunding bonds as well. Another issue that we had discussed with our congressional delegation in particular is Yucca Mountain hazardous material shipments, and that's what I had mentioned before in my comments, that we did discuss this with our congressional delegation. And then, of course, broadband access, that what we do is we support increased funding for CDBG and Choice Neighborhood Grants and the expansion of HUD Connect Home Program, and the financial viability of broadband infrastructure investment with policies for inclusion of broadband infrastructure in federally funded infrastructure projects. Basically, we want to make sure everybody's got infrastructure or has broadband access, and especially in the underserved areas. We discussed the reauthorization for surface transportation and the Army Corps of Engineers. You were hoping to get the reauthorization for that. Other issues, I'm just going to name these off: housing, opioid epidemic, 2020 census, equitable economic development, community resilience, race and equity, connecting children to nature, reducing overuse of jails for young adults, finance and pensions, blockchain technology, solar power, opportunity zones, innovation ecosystems, recycling, climate change, immigration, active shooters, and natural disasters. The top five priorities on housing are community and neighborhood engagement, which I think we do that very, very well. Land use, regional planning, federal resources,
and local housing regarding market rate, affordable, and homelessness. And the Community and Economic Committee, Economic Development Committee, there was a concern with the disconnect for salaries and housing. Some people make too much money to qualify for affordable housing, but those same people don't make enough money for market rate housing. So there's an issue, there's a disconnect there with affordability and housing, and not everybody, you know, it qualifies for affordable housing, but yet they don't make enough money to buy a market rate home. Some of the key themes are urban innovation, cities and technology infrastructure, sustainability, housing affordability again with and homelessness, and as well as veterans, public finance and economic development. So those were through the Community and Economic Development Committee. In the Military Community Council, the issues that were discussed were transportation and housing. They would like to start a Purple Heart Home chapter for Operation Veteran Home Renovation Project. And I've talked to some of our Purple Heart members from the Military Order Purple Hearts Chapter 730. And there is one person that is an attorney that says that he would love to help out with a new chapter. So we're going to be working with our Vietnam Veterans of America and American Legion, VFW, to see if there's a way to get a chapter together. The Operation Veteran Home Renovation Project is for veterans who need to remodify their house in order to accommodate whatever needs that they have. If you have a veteran that comes home and now you have to, you know, in their house, it's a normal house, but now all of a sudden they have a wheelchair or there's something that they need to modify in their home in order to accommodate whatever it is that they need. And they also discuss the base realignment and closures. It's always something, the BRAC is always an issue that that comes around that is very concerning for our military bases. In the Western Municipal Association, the issues included climate change. There's talk in all branches of government about raising the gas tax. So this is Congress, Senate, and the President. They're all talking about raising the gas cap, the gas tax, and charging for vehicle miles traveled for electric vehicles who don't require gas. Electric vehicles use the roads and do not pay any gas tax because they don't take gas to maintain the roads. So that's a discussion that's happening in Congress. In the first tier suburbs committee, there was a discussion on suburban challenges and opportunities, and understanding and responding to the forces that shape maturing neighborhoods. So that's an issue through the first tier suburbs. And I think there's a whole lot. Went to a lot of different meetings. I ended up this year on the board, because I serve on the board of directors, so I'm the board liaison for the Asian Pacific American Municipal Officials. And as a board member and being assigned as a liaison for that, I had to read a report of what's happened at the board of directors meeting. And so I did that with the Asian Pacific American Municipal Officials meeting. But then I also did that for the first tier suburbs meeting. I helped out there, and then I went next door to the Military Community Council. And it's because the people, there's so many things that are happening at the conference, you can't be everywhere. But apparently I was in three different places, and the other people who were the liaisons were in all different other places, so we just kind of covered for each other. And one other thing is that the 2023 conference, it was voted on to be in Atlanta, Georgia. In November, the conference is in San Antonio, Texas, and I encourage everyone to go and get information, bring back information. This was my last conference that I'll ever go to for National League of Cities. And so we do need to make sure that Henderson is at the table and that we're the influencers. We're not the ones being influenced. And so that's why I go to these meetings, and I am a part of these committees. I'm a part of the board, is because I want to make sure that Henderson's at the table and that we're the ones who can affect change nationwide that come back over to our own city and can benefit those people here.
Thank you very much for your leadership, Councilwoman, and for attending those meetings and representing Henderson well.
Thank you. And I hope that somebody else will take over from me. Councilman?
Yes, Mayor, thank you. there is an issue that I have been, that has really concerned me for a long time. And I guess I'm finally tired of it. And I think it's something that I would like to put on an agenda. There are many subdivisions in our city that don't have homeowners associations. In the homeowners association, there are certain CC&Rs that require yards to be kept at a certain level, and if they aren't, the homeowners association has the ability to go in and fine and do whatever they need to do to bring those homes up to standard. When you don't have a homeowners association, you have to rely on the city, and we don't give code enforcement adequate remedies to enforce anything that we have. I'll give you an example. There are, in our older neighborhoods, in Jerry's ward, in North Green Valley, all the way in Ward 3, you're going to see a lot of neighborhoods that don't have homeowners associations. And as you drive through, you will see homes that are pristinely maintained, and next door to them, you've got yards that have weeds that are 5 feet high, 3 feet high. They're a mess. And the poor people in those neighborhoods that do everything they can to maintain their yards, their home values are going down because there are neighbors that will not keep up their property. And so a neighbor can call code enforcement can go out, and they can say to the homeowner, you have X number of days to clean up your yard to this standard. The standard is cut the weeds down to 6 inches. So they go with a weed whacker, and they cut all the weeds down to 6 inches, and 3 weeks or 4 weeks later, the weeds are a foot and a half high again. And this is an ongoing process. There's no end to the remedy. And because I live around those neighborhoods, I have to say that eventually these are going to be neighborhoods that people aren't going to want to live in, because we aren't, as a city, doing our job of going in and protecting those people who have a right to live. They bought in a decent neighborhood. They have a right to live in a decent neighborhood. And yeah, I understand people have property rights, but they don't have the right to bring down a neighborhood. And I think that we as a council, it's about time we address this. It's been something that we have talked off and on about since the time I've been on this council, which has been a long time, and yet we haven't done the things necessary to give code enforcement the tools to go in and enforce it. And I would like to have a presentation on what our rules are. I'd like to have a discussion on whether we need to change them. And I'd like to have a discussion on then what tools we need to give code enforcement to make homeowners understand we're serious about them maintaining their yards to a minimum standard.
And on top of that, also, what programs are there to help people? Because I did have a constituent come to me and complain about their neighbor, and he said that he finally went over to her house, waited for her to come home. She had just got home from dialysis. So she doesn't have the ability to go out there and cut her grass. You know, she's got her health that she's thinking about. And I asked him, I said, well, you know, did you ask her if you would be okay for you to clean her yard? Or, you know, just see if there's something that can
You're absolutely
can
help. Right.
Yeah, so I think that we can to have that information inform us what kinds of projects or any kind of whatever kind of ability there is to help people who are not able to keep up.
I agree.
Yeah, Richard, perhaps we could research best practices around the country, what other communities are doing more aggressive or have other effective tools to address.
I just don't want this to be something that is put off 7 or 8 months. Mm-hmm. I've put off this conversation for a long time. And I'd really like to have the conversation.
Great. Any other comments? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and set the meeting. The next regular meeting will be on April 9th at 2019 at 6 in the evening due to the primary elections being held on April 2nd. And this is the time set aside for public comment. Is there anyone wishing to speak in the public comment period? Seeing no one, come forward, please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Tom Stampar, 89015. In the comments that you were making on the radioactive thing, I know this sounds funny, but weapons-grade plutonium is not highly radioactive. It sounds like a good political statement, but if somebody reads that knows, they're going to say, realize that you're just speaking politically, not scientifically.
Thank you. And this meeting is adjourned.